You know, I speak all the time, and for this bizarre reason tonight, I am incredibly nervous, which is somewhat unlike me. I think maybe it's the sensation of talking about coming to San Francisco to speak about gay issues. I just went to Newcastle and brought coals, so I thought, you know, maybe that's why I'm intimidated. But I grew up in rural North Carolina, and anybody who is from there will be unsurprised that I start my speech by telling you, let me tell you a story. Storytelling's a great tradition in my family, who's lived in the mountains of Appalachia for 200 years. And my story centers around an incident that happened to me about a year and a half ago at this time. In August of 1995 in Merrimack, New Hampshire, thanks to the help of the Traditional Values Coalition based in Southern California, the local school board was taken control of by religious conservatives. And they passed a policy which banned any program that had the intent or effect of promoting homosexuality as a positive lifestyle alternative, if I recall the wording correctly. And there were a lot of local people in Merrimack, New Hampshire, who were outraged by this. And at the night they were going to pass this policy, they asked me if I would come to New Hampshire to speak. And I said, sure. And I got my little Nissan, and I drove up to New Hampshire. And I got there, and I was dressed much like I am today. And I've discovered this is actually a great benefit to me, because for whatever reason, when I go into those places, the Christian Coalition people think I'm one of them. This is helpful in some ways, because my dad was a Baptist preacher, and I was taught, I memorized 25 Bible verses a night as a child. My dad could actually recite the entire New Testament from memory, Matthew through Revelation. Anyway, I think they have this stereotype of gay activists, you know, kind of how I would dress at school, which is not like this, but actually wearing a leather jacket. But when I've always taught, when you're speaking in public, wear a jacket and tie. So I was wearing my jacket and tie. And I got to this meeting, which was actually quite an education, because it was packed with people on our side. People in the town were really outraged at this policy, which came as a big surprise to me. And the Christian Coalition types were kind of traumatized and huddling into a corner. And I started taking notes, because I always like to take notes so I can remember things. And they thought I was a reporter. So they came sort of like a large amoeba and surrounded me. And they said, are you a reporter? And I thought, well, I've got my chance. And I said, well, I'm a writer. Because my dad also taught me never lie. And they proceeded to spew all of their frustration with this hearing, which was going very badly for them, at me. And I'm taking frantic notes. And I had a very interesting conversation with one of the women in particular. She was a single mom. She had a fourth grader and a second grader. And I actually learned a lot from her. She was very concerned about her children's future. Would they get the education they needed to survive in the global economy? And it was very clear that she saw this whole debate and the whole issue of gay and lesbian issues in schools as distracting the schools from doing what she wanted them to do, which was to ensure a good future for her children. And so she finally reaches over and like grabs me by the lapels and yells in my face, what does homosexuality have to do with education anyway? And I thought, good question. And so that's the theme for my talk tonight. What does homosexuality have to do with education? Because if we can't answer that question in a way that this mom in New Hampshire, who I contend is not our enemy, but is our potential supporter, if we can't answer that question in the way that she can understand, we will not be successful in our effort to create schools that are safe for all students. So that's kind of how I frame things tonight. What does homosexuality have to do with education anyway? Now, there's several ways you could answer that question. One is to simply let students speak for themselves. Let me share with you one of the things one of my students wrote for me. A day in which the issue of sexual orientation is not mentioned or spoken about in school would be unusual. Every day I am forced to listen to the unaccepting or ignorant people around me. There seems to be no escape. Lately, I've started to lose hope altogether. It feels like nothing I can do will make a difference. If I confront the homophobia around me, it takes up all my time and energy, and I feel totally alone in doing it. I hear homophobic comments all the time in my classes. Sometimes I think teachers don't hear what goes on in their classrooms, but other times I think they don't listen. Maybe they don't listen to the offensive comments because the issue isn't important to them. I think there is a difference when it's people like you who are being constantly slandered, misunderstood, and hated. And I want teachers to remember that I can't block out the homophobia. I hear it even when I don't want to listen. I hear it every day that I am in this school, and it hurts a lot. Now, for many of us in the audience, whether we're gay or straight allies, I didn't read anything to you that you didn't already know. The fact of the matter is that for quite a long time, school has been a literal place of torture for most gay and lesbian youth. Sometimes it is physical torture. A study just released in Seattle showed that 15% of gay youth in their school system have not only been attacked, but attacked to the point where they required medical treatment by a doctor as a result of the attack. 15% of those kids have had to go to a doctor because of what's happened to them at school. And beyond that, I think there are the psychic wounds that are the greatest, the invisibility. The sitting there while, according to one study we did in Massachusetts, you hear 97% of the kids said they hear their peers use words like faggot or dyke on a regular basis. Or, as we found among second graders in Massachusetts, the number two most commonly used insult among those children was, "That's so gay." Second graders, 7 and 8 years old. What does that do to the spirit of a young person? Many of us know, because we've experienced it ourselves. Let me read you another piece of writing. At 3:40 today, Tracy called me and told me she had slashed her wrists and taken 2 bottles of pills. Tracy is a brave young woman who has struggled to come to terms with her sexual orientation and has bravely taken the lead in raising awareness on our campus as one of the heads of our Gay Straight Alliance. She said to me on the phone, "I always thought when I reached the breaking point, it would be some big thing that pushed me over the edge, but it's not." Later, at the hospital, while waiting for her father to arrive from out of town, she said to me, "What do I say when he asks me why I did it? Dad, I just don't fit in with the world." As Tracy convulsed in her hospital bed, her stomach torn to bits by the pills she had taken, I murmured, I know, and in fact, I do know. Because yes, just like you, Tracy, I took 140 aspirin one night in high school because I couldn't see a way out. I couldn't see a future. I couldn't see a way to go on. You see, when you're a gay teenager, you don't need some big thing to push you over the edge, as Tracy discovered. You get the message every day of your life, just like Tracy did, that you just don't fit in with the world. You get it driven through your skull. Sooner or later, you get the message. You get the point. Tracy got the point at about 3:40 this afternoon. Wonderful, brave Tracy, whom everybody thinks has it so together with her student leadership position and her 1420 on her SAT. Yeah, Tracy got the point today. I wrote that. And what struck me as I sat next to Tracy in her hospital bed in 1991 was that it was exactly 10 years, almost to the day, that I had tried to do the same thing to myself. And the startling news that I bring for those of us in enclaves like San Francisco or New York, where I live now, is that in most American schools, it's no better than it was when you were there, whether that's 10 years ago, 20 years ago, 30 years ago, 40 years ago. And in fact, in many schools in this city, it's no better. I want to see history quit repeating itself. Now, in order to understand what homosexuality has to do with public education, we have to go back, and you'll excuse me, you can take the history teacher out of the classroom, but you cannot take the classroom out of the history teacher and have a history lesson. Now, we can appeal to this woman that I met in New Hampshire on the sheer basis of student welfare and say it's bad for the kids. We could present the statistics are on our side. We could present the moving testimonies. But I contend that these will not be effective because there are certain historical forces we have to first take into account in order to make an effective argument to this woman. And the first historical force we have to take into account, I knew this was not going to last. I just can't stay at a podium for long. The first historical force we have to take into account is, why are there public schools in America? Where did they come from? Why do they exist? Public schools in America were started in the 1830s in Massachusetts by Horace Mann. It was called the Common School Movement. Why was it called the Common School Movement? For a couple of reasons. First of all, Mr. Mann thought that making sure that every child had a chance to get an education was a fundamental element of democracy, that an educated citizenry was a prerequisite for people's ability to govern themselves. So therefore, we had to have public schools to make sure everybody could get an education. But secondly, he called them the Common School because he thought part of the mission of public education was to bring together all the different kinds of people in the community so that they could learn to get along in a heterogeneous society. It was really critical that people from different walks of life all went to school together, that people were not segregated into separate kinds of schools. And this was the whole idea behind public education. And America, as you're aware, I'm sure, was the first country in the world to set up free public education for all of its citizens, because we saw it as a fundamental element of democracy. Everybody had to be able to learn. Everybody had to have access to education, and everybody had to go to schools with different kinds of people so that they would learn from different kinds of people. It's a fundamental building block of democracy. Now, with that argument, that easily makes it apparent to people why we need to address homophobia, because it prevents people from getting an education. It blocks equal opportunity to education. But this argument is not enough for us either, because we're still ignoring some more history. The second lesson history teaches us is that whenever a minority group is making progress towards equality in Western culture, the number one attack made on them is, they're after your kids. Go back in Western history. Think about the Middle Ages, when Jews were supposedly killing Christian children and drinking their blood in the Passover Seder, and how that was used to justify pogroms against Jews. Think about the American South, where I grew up, where 1,200 black men were lynched between 1900 and 1925, almost universally because they supposedly had been after little white girls. Throughout history, this has been a very effective act of aggression against minorities. Why? Well, those of you who are PFLAG parents in the room don't need me to tell you this. What's the number one concern of a parent? Is my child safe? And if you believe someone's a threat to your child's safety, the average parent is going to do whatever they can, like that single mom I met in New Hampshire who's working 12 hours a day as it is, who's trying to take care of two kids for herself, but somehow finds the time to come to that school board meeting. Why? Because she's a bigot? Because she's a bad person? No, because she's a good mom who thinks there's a threat to her children. Why does she think that? Because the third lesson of history is, throughout gay and lesbian history, the most effective attack on us in particular has been to claim that we are threats to children, that we are child molesters, that we are predatory, etc. Now, of course, this does fly in the face of all statistics. The study done in Colorado based on reported child abuse cases found that a child was 100 times more likely to be molested by a heterosexual male family member than by a gay or lesbian person. And my personal theory about that report, it's an underestimate. Because if you think about it, the vast majority of child sexual abuse is committed by adult male family members, and it doesn't get reported. I think a child's probably 500, 1,000, 2,000, 3,000, 4,000 more times likely to be molested by one of their male family members than by a gay or lesbian person. So it's not a question, though, of facts. It's a question of what people have been taught throughout history. Let's go back. 1950, in the Becoming Visible book I did, I excerpted it. The American Senate did its first report on gay and lesbian people. Remember the McCarthy era and how gay people were supposedly giving away all our secrets to the Russians and stuff? They conducted an investigation. And they published a report called Employment of Homosexuals and Other Sex Perverts by the Federal Government. First ever published report, 1950. You can't blame it on Jesse Helms. So what does this report say? It says there's two reasons why you can't employ federal homosexuals as federal employees. Number one, because they will give away all our secrets to the Russians because they're easily blackmailed. And since they're homosexuals, they have weak emotional constitutions and they will collapse quickly under interrogation. Perhaps a grain of truth. Secondly, because they will convince younger federal employees to become homosexuals. Okay? Now, not so long after that, 1977, remember Anita Bryant? She was not just for breakfast anymore. She was for homophobia, as we recall. And she launched her Save Our Children campaign in the late 70s, you know, which manifested itself in California, of course, with the Briggs Initiative. And in 1994, when Lon Maybaum was launching his latest anti-gay referendum campaign in Oregon, guess what their slogan was? Protect our children. Now, what we learn here is a very fascinating lesson, which is the right wing does not believe in recycling paper and cans, but they do recycle ideas very efficiently. They have one big idea, and it keeps coming back, sort of like the dinosaurs in Jurassic Park. They just keep coming back with one simple idea. Now, this is very devastating to us because we have this good mom in New Hampshire, right? Who's working hard to take care of her kids, who's working hard to make sure their kids have opportunity in the future, who's worried that her schools are not up to the job. And she starts hearing from these large right-wing groups like Traditional Values Coalition that these people are foisting a homosexual agenda on her children, that her children are somehow going to be recruited into this dangerous lifestyle where they're more prone to get AIDS, where we're more prone to be beaten up, all these awful things are going to happen. What did we expect her to do? Applaud? She's going to be very, very nervous, and she's going to want to come to that board meeting. She's going to want to stop it. Now, how do we speak to her then? How do we find a way to talk to this woman so that she understands that homosexuals are not a threat to her children? Homophobia is the threat to her children. Because if we can't help her understand that, we won't be effective. And if we can't know that history that she's coming in with, all that baggage, all that fear, and all that stereotyping, all that misinformation that she's been fed, that's being reinforced day after day after day through videotapes like the Gay Agenda or direct mail campaigns or all kinds of ways in which she's being told to be afraid, how do we make her less afraid? This was the problem that we confronted in 1992 in Massachusetts when our governor, William Weld, appointed a commission on gay and lesbian youth, and I was appointed to co-chair the Education Committee, which was charged with finding ways to change our schools to make them more accepting around gay and lesbian issues. We knew this history, okay? And we knew that we would have to somehow effectively address that history if we were going to somehow make changes. Now, I'll tell you the end of the story before I tell you what we did. In 1993, Massachusetts passed a law making it the first state to ban anti-gay discrimination in its public schools. It set up the first statewide program to address homophobia schools called Safe Schools for Gay and Lesbian Students. And as of an email I got yesterday, out of 320 public high schools in Massachusetts, 105 have gay-straight alliances now. One-third of all high schools in the state have a gay-straight alliance student support program. Something worked. So the question is what? And I have kind of three lessons to offer to people from what we learned there that might be helpful as you think about it here. And I know that people are working very hard here. I read about the lobby day and everything in Sacramento to replicate some of these achievements in California, so I hope that these will be helpful to you as you're trying to do this. The number one lesson we learned is you got to reframe the issue. That if a debate is basically won in the first 10 seconds, that if this becomes a debate over whether or not we molest children, there's no way we can win that debate. And I always demonstrate this by asking you a question. Don't think about chimpanzees. What are you all thinking about? Chimpanzees, okay? The longer we argue over whether or not we're child molesters, what's that mom, what's the image, what's the film running through that mom's head in New Hampshire? Child molester, child molester, child molester, John Wayne Gacy, child molester, child molester. She can't even hear what we're saying because the whole issue of child molestation, things like that, make her so nervous she's freaking out. And that, by the way, is not the issue at hand. So it's very important that we reframe it and we set the terms of the debate so that people understand what the issue is at hand. So we thought a lot about this in Massachusetts, and we called our report Making Schools Safe for Gay and Lesbian Youth. Because we wanted to put the issue in terms that people could relate to, terms that they could understand. No one's going to be in favor of child molesters being around their kids, okay? And even if, you know, you win the debate, there's always that lingering suspicion. No one's also going to be in favor of an unsafe school. So we knew by framing it the way we did that our opponents would automatically be on the defensive. Because, and also the fact of the matter was they were in favor of the unsafe schools. They wanted what was going on in our schools to continue and kids to keep getting beaten up and kids to keep killing themselves. They need to be called to task for that. So they became the party of suicide and violence, and we became the party of safe schools. Guess what? It's easy to win that election. So we found this was really important to do, that it was more important almost what the question was being asked than what the answer to the question was. That once we turn the question into, do you want safe schools for your students, we couldn't lose. That if the question had remained, are gays child molesters, are gays threat to children, we couldn't win. So reframing is issue number one. Lesson number two that I would offer is that we need to reframe ourselves in a way that is universal and appeals to everyone. Like, I don't think I've said the word, or maybe I've said it once or twice, the word homophobia much yet, because that's not a word I use very much anymore. Because it's a word that a lot of people kind of shut down when they hear it. So what's something universal that everybody believes in that is that fighting homophobia in schools is related to? Well, how about equal opportunity for everybody to get an education? How about children being safe from being harassed? By starting to talk in that language, people like that mom who would never support fighting homophobia in schools could suddenly hear what we were talking about. And she could hear that and say, that's something that I actually believe in. That's something that I can support. And I think it's a cardinal rule about using those universal principles. You got to meet people where they live. You know, I think we've all heard the joke, how many gay and lesbian activists does it take to change a light bulb? That's not funny! The fact of the matter is that if we continue to kind of harangue and berate that woman in New Hampshire, we're never going to win her over. Whereas in reality, she should be on our side because she too wants to see schools that perform well for children. She just doesn't understand that we are the ones who want that too, not the religious right. So use universal organized themes, but also third, we knew that we had to use universal organizing. That it couldn't just be gay people who were speaking up around this. It couldn't be just teachers. It had to be gay and straight, teacher and student, community member and educator, Republican and Democrat, people of color and white. So we were very careful when we did our organizing to make sure that all of the community was represented. Because we knew, of course, as you know, that a special rights agenda attack was one of the most effective ways to attack it on what we were trying to do. If it was gay teachers trying to force their sexuality on children, it was dead in the water. But if we had all people in the community involved, parents, students, teachers, we kind of recreated the PTSA coalition in a way, because we knew that that was really critical to helping people understand what we were about. And that disarmed the ability of our opponents to portray us as some kind of special rights agenda. But the fourth, I think, and most important thing that we have to do was to put a human face on it for these people. Because a lot of these people that we were dealing with had a hard time imagining gay people at all. You know, and if they did, they probably imagined Uncle Arthur and Bewitched or something like that. You know, that was about their consciousness level. And certainly there were no gay kids, okay? That was just completely oxymoronic to them. There was no such thing as a gay youth. So one of the things we did is we made sure that every senator in the state actually met with a gay student from their district. And when those students would tell their stories about what happened to them, like one kid named Mark from Belmont, Massachusetts, who had been surrounded by a soccer team and had been spit on so much that his entire jersey was dripping with spit off of it. His senator, who was a conservative Republican, became one of the sponsors of the bill. Or when another kid named Dan from Newton, Massachusetts, talked about being shoved into a locker and having the locker locked and left there for several periods by his peers because they knew he was gay, that senator suddenly turned around. Because it quit being an issue of the bogeyman, the molester, the frightening other, and it became someone they knew. And when they went onto the floor of the Senate to vote, if they voted against us, they were voting against that kid. And they couldn't bring themselves to do it because they knew it was wrong. 3 years before we passed this bill in Massachusetts, we had passed our first gay rights bill, virtually the same senators. We passed that bill by a 21-19 vote. We passed the gay and lesbian students' rights bill by a 33-7 vote because the senators understood it as an issue of welfare for the students they had personally sat down with and talked to. And the most amazing thing about this was it was the students who made this happen. 500 of them came to our state house and staged a rally and went into the senators' offices and said, "We're not leaving until you meet with us." And they stayed there until sometimes into the evening until senators came out. And I thought, for me as a history teacher also, I thought it was a great lesson in democracy. Here were kids seeing that this was their government, they could have an impact, they could make a difference, democracy actually could work. And so if nothing else, I thought it was the best civics lesson the kids in my school got, much better than what they got in my history class. So I think those four lessons, the issue of framing the issue appropriately, using universal language when talking to people, organizing across lines of sexual orientation and race and politics, and putting a human face on it were what enabled us to be successful in Massachusetts and what enabled us to pass our law. Now, in the 3 years since we passed that law, things have become very hot in this country around this issue. You may have just seen the National School Boards Association study that was released that showed that 54% of all school board members in this country are religious conservatives. 54%. And you may also be aware that Ralph Reed, the executive director of the Christian Coalition, has set a goal of taking over 2,500 school boards in this country in the next 2 years. Why are they doing this, you might ask? Well, I think they're doing it for a very basic reason. And it's two basic reasons. One is, if they can control what the next generation learns, they can make sure homophobia goes on forever. The next generation is what happens in our schools. But secondly, it's a wedge issue. Those of you who are not educators or not involved with youth may think, well, this has nothing to do with me. But if they can successfully demonize gay people as a threat to children, which is what this is all about, then it's not going to stop with preventing pro-gay programs in schools. It's going to keep going. Because if someone's a threat to your children, you don't want them living next to you, you don't want them working with you, you don't want them in your community. This becomes the way to terrorize people and feed a whole new level of anti-gay backlash. We saw Anita Bryant do that in the late 70s when we saw the massive repeal of gay rights ordinances around this country. And they've learned that worked once, and they will do it again. So that's why they are putting all this emphasis on it. And it puts us at an extreme disadvantage because they are organized in every community in the country. And also, we sent our director of field services, John Spear, to their convention to study them and see what they were doing. And we discovered, one of the facts they've uncovered is that in the average school board election in America, you only have to win 8% of all eligible voters to get elected. Now, I will tell you a fact. 8% of every community in America is crazy. So they don't need to win everybody. They just have to get 8% of crazy people out there, and they're in control of your school board. And the control of your school board leads to much larger things. Think of school boards. They're the farm team for the majors. They're where the future legislative candidates, the future gubernatorial candidates, the future presidential candidates get their start. So I think this is a very dangerous threat to the gay community that in a lot of ways is hard for us to see because it's kind of flying underneath our radar. Because a lot of gay people have no connection with schools and would never think of going to a school board meeting or even turning out for a school board election. Why should I? I don't have kids in schools. And a lot of our straight allies don't either. So here they are making their wedge issue in, starting to demonize us, starting to control what happens in the schools. And we're not even aware it happens sometimes until it's too late. We can win this. Remember Merrimack, New Hampshire? Remember that mom? Last May, that school board was turned out of office in what was basically a referendum on the gay policy they had passed. Why? Because our chapter in New Hampshire went back to the issue of history. They started talking to people about what public schools were for, about the fact that every kid has a right to go to school and not be harassed and not be attacked and not be made fun of and not be made to feel like they don't belong. And the good people of New Hampshire, which in New England is nicknamed the Mississippi of the North, the good people of New Hampshire, live free or die, the good people of New Hampshire turned those folks out of office. Because they realized that the values they put on their license plate, live free or die, were the values that we were standing for, not these folks who wanted you basically to live their way or die. That's what we have to start talking to middle America about. They have to start understanding that the values that the kids pledge allegiance to in school, remember liberty and justice for all, are the values that we stand for. Now, I think that on a more personal level, we have to think about what happens for kids if we can achieve our work. And I'll share with you two things that I've received. This is a letter I got from a lady named Emily Ladner in Bel Air, Texas. Dear Glisson, we're sending you a check because our son was tormented throughout his school years and often blamed by teachers and principals for inviting this mistreatment. His tormentors were never punished. We hope you can change the atmosphere in our schools. I think a lot, I actually literally do carry this letter with me. You can see by how worn out it is. The first reason why we have to win this fight is because somewhere out there today in Bel Air, Texas, or Louisville, North Carolina, where I grew up, or maybe in San Francisco, California, there was a kid at school today who went to school thinking he belonged, maybe, thinking he had friends, thinking that this was his school, who was called faggot, who was spit upon, who was beaten, who started learning a lesson early on in his school life, which is that pledge we make kids say in school, equal justice for all, is a lie. We don't mean it. That there are all kinds of exceptions to it. And that for him, or for that young lesbian, there's the gay exemption. And they start losing their faith in this nation. They start losing their faith in the ideals that they're being taught in school. And this reminds me of something I read in the book, I Dream a World, Portraits of Black Women Who Changed America. You've seen this book. There's a wonderful interview with a lady who has been teaching kindergarten in South Carolina for about 65 years. She's in her 80s. And the interviewer asks her, when is the worst period you've lived through? And she said, oh, today. And she says, and the interviewer says, how can you say that? You lived through segregation. You lived through lynchings, etc. And she said, because today what I see among young people is a belief that nothing can ever change, that things can never get better. And I will tell you what, nothing is sadder than a cynical young person because they've gone from knowing nothing to believing in nothing. How can we, I thought often about this when I was teaching. I would look at my students, I would look at the students who were gay, I would look at the students who were female, and I would look at the students who were students of color, and I'd look at all kinds of kids, and I would think how sad it is for these kids to know that there's a limit to what they get in life in this country, that they've been told that they'll get everything, but we don't really mean it. How sad it is for them to learn from an early age that adults don't tell the truth. I want to start telling the truth in this country. I want those little kids to sit in that class and to imagine that the world is theirs. I don't want any more letters like this from Bel Air, Texas. I don't want any more little kids to think that their future has a limit just because they are gay or lesbian, or for any number of different reasons. I always thought that I was doing this work to help gay kids, perhaps to help them come out of the closet. I always thought gay people were the only ones who came out of the closet. And a few years ago, when I was on sabbatical, I had a student, we had a tradition at my school of chapel talks, where students got to give up and give a 15-minute talk to the entire school their senior year. These were completely uncensored and unpreviewed talks, and which is quite nerve-wracking for us teachers. But also it was a wonderful event because the students really owned the space. They got to say what they really thought, what they really felt, and that was very important to them. And they looked forward to it for years. And I was on sabbatical, and I had given one a couple of years before in which I had talked about growing up gay and what that was like because teachers gave them sometimes too. And I got this from a girl I'd had in class with a little note attached saying, Dear Kevin, I miss you. You're on sabbatical this year. I thought you'd want to read my chapel. And my first thought was, what an arrogant little kid. You know, she just assumes everybody wants to read her chapel. I later felt somewhat ashamed when I actually read what she had written. It's kind of lengthy, but I want to read it to you because I think it speaks to the larger agenda, since we'll use the right wing word, that we're trying to accomplish through our work. I look back on my elementary school years, and I feel a certain amount of longing for the little girl that was me. She knew she was smart, she knew she was beautiful, and nobody was going to tell her different. She had changed by the time she was 10 or so. She had stopped believing she had talent or brains or worth. By the time I entered fourth grade, I hated being a girl. Why shouldn't I? I had to fight harder for attention than the 20 boys in my crowded classroom of 37. My fifth grade teacher told me I'd never have a boyfriend if I couldn't learn how to keep my mouth shut. Every storybook I read, every TV show I watched, every billboard on the highway seemed to tell me that I mattered less, that any value I had was purely aesthetic. Perhaps most of all, I hated my body for making me vulnerable. When I was a little girl, a man taught me I had no control over what happened to my body, and I believed him. I never blamed him for my abuse. I blamed my sex. After all, he couldn't have done these things to me if I wasn't a girl. I started having regular nightmares about rape and being raped when I was 12 years old. If I wasn't born a girl, I thought, I would be immune. If I did not possess this anatomical vulnerability, I would be free. Men and boys were my enemy, and at the same time, they were the yardstick against which I measured my worth as a human being. I hated boys who only wanted to be my friend because of the way I looked, but at the same time, I desperately wanted them to like me. My appearance was what was important to people, and as much as I hated it, I was convinced it was true. I was told I was pretty or skinny by total strangers, but nobody seemed to notice the things I worked to be good at. People, especially boys, liked me because of the way I looked, and naturally I wanted to be liked. So looking good or looking right became more important than anything, and in my world, this meant staying thin. I can remember staring at the reflection of my naked 11-year-old child's body and feeling that I wanted to die, overwhelmed with shame and disgust at fat, fat, fat me. I began to grow terrified that I would gain weight and lose my value in the eyes of my parents, my teachers, and the boys I wanted to please. So one sunny morning in April, I bought my first package of diet pills in the Concord CVS. Some women I know can and do lose 10 pounds in 1 week, but I found it impossible to stop eating altogether, so I took triple doses of diet pills and went to class shaking too hard to take notes. Fasting got harder and harder, and when I gave in and ate, I hated myself for being weak, for being out of control. It didn't take me long to find the solution. 1, 2, as many as 7 times a day, I would carefully tie my hair back and purge. When my stomach was comfortably void, I washed my face, brushed my teeth, and continued on with my day. For close to 2 years, nobody knew what was happening. I was good at hiding the truth. My parents, my sisters, and my friends were all oblivious to what was going on, often in the next room. My throat swelled up. I stopped getting my period. My hair began to fall out. I was a mess. Then last year, Kevin Jennings gave a chapel that changed my life. He talked about courage and about strength. He said that while it takes a certain amount of strength to force oneself to do what society demands to conform to someone else's ideals, it takes far more to be what you want, to be true to who you are on the inside. That has stuck with me throughout my struggle to change my definition of strength and courage. I used to pride myself on my control and willpower. I used to congratulate myself on every pound shed. To me, that was real strength. What I have since realized is that what I was really doing was giving power back to people who deserved it least. Every time I stepped with trepidation onto the scale, I supported the English teacher who told me I was too pretty to be smart. Every time I had a diet pill for breakfast, I agreed with my dad that yes, indeed, I could stand to lose a couple of pounds. Every time I purged, I let the man who abused me tell me yet again that my body was not mine, but his. And with this chapel, I am rejecting all of that. I am telling everybody that, most of the time, I love who I am and I love what I am. The ghost of my abuser will no longer haunt me because I know now that I have the power to say no. And I know I have the right. I'm no longer willing to live my life for other people or by other people's standards. I will say what I want and do what I want and eat what I want. I am taking back my body and I am making it my own. There isn't a woman in this room without the power to free herself from her cage of imagined fat and invented cellulite, and I am up here today to tell you it is worth it. I can't say I love my body, but I am happier than I can ever remember being. I'm 20 pounds heavier than I was 7 months ago, yet I take pride in my body now. I used to wonder what I would have to live for without my slim appearance. Now I can't believe how much more I can do and feel and enjoy when I don't have to worry about constantly getting rid of my lunch. I wasted 4 years hating myself because of the body I was born with, and I don't deserve to be hated. None of us do. People have asked me what my chapel will be about, and now that it is done, I think I can answer them. It is about growing up female, about the pain of believing you are worthless, and the joy of discovering you were wrong. As you must imagine, I was completely blown away to get this in the mail and read it. And it also it left me with a very important lesson that we often don't know as teachers the impact we're having for years to come in the lessons we teach. And I was also struck by the fact that Biz was an exceptionally smart young woman because she somehow figured out that my real game plan in coming out as a gay man was to be a role model for heterosexual bulimic girls. you know, if you think about it, she and I have nothing in common, right? You know, gay, white, Southern, Baptist preacher son, man, heterosexual, bulimic, Jewish, Northern, wealthy girl, okay? On those traditional demographics, we don't match up. So why did Biz see me as her role model in this world of, you know, where we're all being put in our own little separate boxes? She should have not been able to see me. Well, that same week, I had a conversation with my mom, which taught me a couple of lessons. Number one, it helped me understand Biz's talk, and number two, it reminded me of a very basic premise that I think we have to move upon, which is that we have to move, as we approach that mom in New Hampshire, under the assumption that everybody can learn. Our schools have to be places where everybody can learn, and we also have to approach even our political opponents with the belief that they can learn. We must never sink to their level and think they are incapable of learning. Now, my mom is one of those people who you would say could never learn. Let me give you the unofficial family biography for Kevin Jennings. I grew up in Louisville, North Carolina, which is a tobacco farming community of about 1,000 people. My dad was a Southern Baptist evangelist. My parents were fairly well-known traveling gospel singers in the South in the 60s. My Uncle Fred was Grand Kleagle of the Ku Klux Klan in the state of North Carolina. And my older brother Mike worked for a senator you might have heard of called Jesse Helms. So I know bigotry. Now, my mom has a sixth grade education. She grew up in Appalachia during the Depression. She's the oldest of 11 children. Her father thought that once a girl had learned to read, write, and figure, she'd had enough education. So he made my mother drop out of school when she was 9 years old and go to work picking cotton and tobacco in the fields of local sharecroppers to support her 11 younger brothers and sisters. My mother then went on. She married at age 17. Which may seem young to you, but you have to remember that my grandmother married at age 11 and had her first child when she was 13. And that by the time she was 17, she already had 3 children. My mother married at 17 without much formal education. And my father died when I was 8, and my mother then supported 5 children working at McDonald's. Imagine supporting 5 children working at McDonald's. She thought Jews had horns until she was 16 years old, a common belief in Appalachia in the early 20th century. When my older brother Alan married an African-American woman in 1971, she didn't speak to him for 4 years. She did improve over time in 1980. When I came out, she didn't speak to me for 3 years. So here's my mom, the woman who is the stereotype of the person who can't change. The woman who founded the first chapter of Parents and Friends of Lesbians and Gays, PFLAG, in the state of North Carolina. Now, I want you to remember also another phrase, which is that change is a process, not an event. It's not like things happen all at once. My mom founded the chapter of PFLAG in 1988, but you know, I was a little nervous because in 1994, I was going to be on a Dateline NBC. It was the first time I'd ever done national television. I thought, I better warn Mom this is coming, because it's one thing to be in your little PFLAG chapter, it's another thing to have your homosexual son on national television, so that everybody in Winston-Salem will know Ms. Jennings' son's a homosexual. So I called to warn Mom, and my mother had just been diagnosed with emphysema and been put on oxygen 24 hours a day. And I told her this show was going to be on the next night at 10 o'clock, and there was this long silence at the other end of the phone. I thought I've killed her. And she finally comes back on, and she says to me, "Now, Kevin, I understand this is real important to you, but do you have to be quite so public about this?" And I said to her what all the PFLAG moms in the audience maybe will be able to relate to this. I said to her the words that I think every Dr. Spock-raised mom dreads to hear. I said, "Yes, Mom, you made me this way." And I went on to say, I said, "Well, did you know how you made me this way, Mom? Do you remember when I was little and we used to go to Robin Hood Road Baptist Church every Sunday morning and Sunday evening and to Wednesday night prayer meeting where my dad was the minister when I was a little boy? And my dad would harp on the Ten Commandments, 'Thou shalt not lie.' And whenever I was little, Mom, when I got in trouble, you'd always set me down. You'd say, 'Remember, Kevin, whatever it is, the truth shall set you free.' Well, guess what, Mom? You turned out to be right." And it was that conversation with my mother that helped me understand why Biz saw me as her role model. Because I had told the truth, and it had set me free. So she told her truth, and it set her free. That's GLSEN's agenda. In a word, let's tell the truth. Right now, our schools play don't ask, don't tell on a lot of issues, and only one of them are gay and lesbian issues. We play don't ask, don't tell for the young girls who are throwing up at lunch because they don't look the way perfect little California girls are supposed to look. We play don't ask, don't tell for kids who don't have enough money to afford the right kinds of clothes to fit in with their peers, for the kids who don't have the same abilities as their peers, for the kids who don't have as much disposable income as their peers, for the kids who've been sexually abused, the kids who are alcoholics, the kids whose parents have alcoholics. We play don't ask, don't tell in a lot of places, and we put a lot of kids in closets. And since I pay about $1,000 a month to rent one in New York City, I can tell you that living in a closet is not a particularly pleasant experience. I think that what we have to do in our schools is wipe out all the closets. Because you can't just tell one truth. Truth has this way of spreading. When I told my truth, suddenly Biz told hers. And I found students of color started getting up at chapel and telling their truths. And all kinds of kids suddenly felt freer. And didn't we establish schools in this country to teach the lesson of freedom? Can we teach the lesson of freedom when we tell so many people, you must lie, you must not tell the truth? I don't think we can. And I also think that people can't learn when they don't get the opportunity to do so. I'm lucky that my mother was a willing learner. And this spring, I was invited back to Winston-Salem, North Carolina, my hometown, where they were having their first ever gay pride parade. And by Winston-Salem standards, I'm what passes for a famous homosexual. So they asked me to come back and speak at it, because I guess I'm the most famous homosexual ever came from Winston-Salem, which is not saying much. But in any case, I came home for the speech, and I had to call my mom and warn her ahead of time this time, because they were going to do a front page article in the newspaper. And I thought, well, you know, people missed the Dateline NBC thing. They're surely going to see this. So I called mom up, and it was in March, I remember. And I was very nervous this time to tell her that I was coming. I was very nervous about how she'd reply. And about halfway through the conversation, my mom said, "Now, Kevin, I've been reading about this march, and I figured you was coming. So I've already made plans to march with you." Now, the story gets even better. Now, when the article came out about a week before Pride, I got paged by my brother, who used to work for Jesse Helms. Now, my brother and I have a very cordial relationship. We are Southern family. If you haven't got anything nice to say, you don't say anything at all. So we never talk. except when my mother is sick. The last time my brother had called me was about a year and a half ago when my mother had a stroke and he found her on the floor of her apartment. And the pager went off, and I saw his number, and I can't even begin. I mean, I get choked up every time I remember. I remember thinking, oh my God, this can't happen. Not a week before I come home to march with my mother in my city's first ever gay pride parade, because I thought my mother's dead. That was all I could think. And I left this restaurant in New York, and I ran down the street. I remember running four blocks before I could find a payphone. And I call my brother up, and I'm like, Mickey, what's going on? And he said, well, I'm very angry at you. That newspaper article came out today. And I was like, oh, Jesus Christ. You know, on the one level, I'm relieved because mom's not dead. And on another level, I'm annoyed because why is he like pulling me out? Okay, and I said, well, Mike, what's the problem here? I said, I didn't use your name. He said, that's exactly the problem. I said, what do you mean? When they'd interviewed me, they said, do you have any family still in Winston-Salem? And I said, yeah, my mom still lives there, but I have a brother who lives there. My mom said I could use her name. And my brother, I said, well, I don't really think he'd want his name in the paper. And that's how they'd printed it. And he said, I've not seen the article at this point, bear in mind. So he reads this to me, and I'm thinking, well, I didn't think you would want to see your name in the paper. What's the problem here? And he said, well, reading this, one would think that I was ashamed of my brother. And I said, yeah. And he said, well, I want you to know that last week at church, now my brother goes to Calvary Baptist Church in Winston-Salem. This is one of those churches where they have about 4,000 people every Sunday. It's where the Christian Coalition actually meets in Winston-Salem. And if you've ever been to a Baptist service, you know that there's a period for witnessing at the end of the service when members of the congregation stand up and witness to the whole congregation. So my brother tells me, it turns out that the preacher in his church is the one who's organizing the counter-protest against the gay pride march. And I just finished this sermon denouncing gays as perverts and bad people and stuff. And he called for people to witness. And my brother went to the microphone and said, I want y'all to know that my brother is the speaker at that march. And I think it would be a sin if you went out and harassed those people. Now, this is my Jesse Helms brother. Now, remember, change is a process, not an event. I have a bad ending for the story. Mike voted for Jesse in November. Because you have to remember that learning is a slow and difficult process. Remember taking French or whatever you took in school? You didn't learn it all the first day, now did you? Takes a while. And for our nation to learn about this issue, it's probably going to take a while, just like it took my mother about 15 years. It may take my brother longer. He is a slow learner. But he seems to be moving. He seems to be moving. And on that day in June in Winston-Salem, when it was 90-some degrees, and my mother came out with her portable oxygen tank and walked down the street in 91-degree heat and you can guess the humidity in Winston-Salem, I thought, if my mother can come this far, surely the schools of our country can come this far. Right before he was shot, Martin Luther King gave a speech in which he said, "Someday children will learn words whose meanings they do not understand. Children in India will ask, what is hunger? Children in Hiroshima will ask, what is an atomic bomb? And children in Alabama will ask, what is segregation? And we will say to them, these are words that no longer have meaning. That is why we have removed them from the dictionary." I've lived long enough to see that Martin Luther King was right. We're hardly over racism in this country, but the Winston-Salem I grew up in and the Winston-Salem that exists today are very different places. In 1971, when our schools were integrated, my mother was the only white mother in our town to put her children on the bus. We were instructed by the bus driver to lay on the floor of the bus because the windows were being shot out across the city by members of the KKK who were wielding sawed-off shotguns. That night, my mom's about 5'1", she weighs maybe 100 pounds, walked across the street to her brother's house, her brother, the Grand Kleagle of the Ku Klux Klan in the state of North Carolina, and said to him that if anyone, he's about 6'4", by the way, weighed about 220, said to him that if any child in Winston-Salem was harmed the next day, she would make sure he wished he had never been born. Now, I'll never know why, but there wasn't another single shot at a bus in Winston-Salem the rest of that school year. Now, I went through school, and white children sat on one side of the classroom, and black children sat on the other, and we never spoke. When I was home in 1996 for my first gay pride parade, I was talking to my niece, who's 13, who boards these buses every day and goes to school in the South, which I might add, by all indicators, is the most integrated area in America today, as opposed to areas in the North and West. And she's known nothing but going to integrated schools and having friends of various racial backgrounds. And I started telling her about when I was in second grade and lay on the floor of the bus, and I had this moment of horror. Some of you probably had it. Ever gotten from your children or your niece or your nephew what I call the crazy Uncle Kevin look? April's looking at me like I'm like, she's like, oh, he's just crazy. My uncle's crazy, you know, because she can't believe this crap. Like maybe she's seen it in history class, but she can't really believe that anyone she knows ever participated in something that was so foolish. She now has to learn about segregation in history class. She has to watch Eyes on the Prize to know it, whereas my generation had to live through it firsthand. When I was home for Gay Pride weekend, my partner, I have to come out of the closet around this, is a Republican. He wanted to get my brother and I in a fight, okay? So he kind of egged us on politically so that we get into a fight. And I said, this is a very Northern cultural custom. Don't do this. Because you don't know where it will end. So my brother and I end up getting in this shouting match about the Employment Non-Discrimination Act and how important it was to pass. And he was just like, well, you're already protected by the Constitution. You don't need special rights. Blah, blah, blah. In the middle of this debate, this is the day after I've told my niece about the segregation thing, my niece looks up and she says, people who are gay can get fired from their job? I think that's ridiculous. 13 years old. Winston-Salem, North Carolina, you have seen the future. She will someday be talking to her children or her nieces and nephews, and she'll explain that she had this uncle who ran this crazy organization that was dedicated to trying to create schools where people were not persecuted because of their sexual orientation. And she'll get the crazy Aunt April look because the children of her children's generation won't get it. They won't understand. Hopefully, homophobia is something they will have to learn about because they saw it in a historical documentary. What's going to make that happen? Two things. I want each of you to go back to school. And I don't mean enroll in a course. I want you, as a result of coming tonight, if you do nothing else, to make contact with someone at the school you attended. I want you to write them. I want you to tell them what homophobia does to young people. I want you to tell them that you went to that school and you saw it firsthand. and I want you to tell them it's got to stop. And you're willing to help make it stop. Because the reason why it continues is because far across this country, there are people who still think they don't have any gay people who ever went to their school or any straight people who had gay children or anything like that. They still think in places like Louisville, North Carolina, that we all live in San Francisco or Provincetown or New York. We've got to go back and tell them different. But secondly, and this is a challenge specifically to the gay and lesbian people in the audience, not every parent in America are like the PFLAG parents who are here tonight or like my mom, as you know. There are millions of gay and lesbian kids who, for all practical purposes, don't have parents. Because what's the function of a parent? To fight for their child and to make sure their child gets the best in life. Many gay and lesbian people have children. I don't, and I don't plan to. So I've changed my notion of what parenthood is. I hope every gay and lesbian person in the audience will start thinking of every gay and lesbian kid out there as their biological child. And that we'll go out and fight for those kids just as hard as we would as if we ourselves had given birth to them. Because there's a whole generation of kids out there who deserve good parents. And we may be the ones who have to provide that support. Because that's the future. Thank you.
Thanks for joining us with GLSEN founder Kevin Jennings. Watch for other PFLAG Talks shows featuring historian Jonathan Ned Katz and Evan Wolfson, director of the Marriage Project of the Lambda Legal Defense and Education Fund. You can purchase a video cassette of this and others in the PFLAG Talks series by sending a check for $25 to Media Production, San Francisco Public Library, Civic Center, San Francisco, California, 94102.